Hello everyone, my name is Boris Merman from Stanford University, and I will be talking about A to D converter, figures of merit, and performance trends. Let's start with the basics. What is a figure of merit? It's a numerical quantity that combines several performance metrics into a single number. And this approach has been used since 1865, so it's not a very new concept. Speaking of performance metrics, there are quite a few for A to D converters, and here I'm not even listing all of them. So as you see, A to D converters are quite complicated. So what then has to happen in reality is that to construct a usable figure of merit, we can only use a subset of these, which is shown on my next slide. So typically, we will only consider the three primary metrics, which are resolution, conversion rate, and power dissipation. So what this means in practice, then, if you report your results, for example, at ISACC or at another conference, it is not sufficient to just list the figure of merit, but to generate a table that lists many other performance aspects that are important about your design. And here I'm showing a very good example that does this in the right way. Now that we've accepted that we want to focus on three primary metrics to construct the figure of merit, how should we combine these and how should we treat them mathematically in this single metric composition? So we need to find a good relationship that describes the trade-off between resolution and power dissipation and conversion rate and power dissipation. And so I will discuss each one of them now. Let's start with conversion rate and power dissipation. So we get a hint from basic physics, which basically says power is energy invested per unit of time. So in A to D converter speak, this means power is energy times the conversion rate. And this is indeed the proportionality that's factored into the standard figures of merit that are used today. There's a little disclaimer to this, and that is, in reality, power is not going to be exactly proportional to conversion rate. It will actually go super linear as you increase and push the speed. And we will return to this point in a couple of minutes. Let's go to the second trade-off between resolution and power dissipation. It turns out that that is much more complicated, simply because it depends on what limits your underlying circuits in the data converter. For example, if your circuits are limited by matching, then power actually grows by a factor of 8 per added bit in resolution. If you are limited by thermal noise, power grows by a factor of 4 per added bit. If you're limited by process technology and feature size, CV square type limitations, power grows by a factor of 2. So what should we use in a practical figure of merit used in ADCs that you can use at conferences and in publication? What we do to answer this question is to look at experimental data. And so that I will start on the next slide. So what I have here is a plot of energy on the y-axis, so power divided by conversion rate. And on the x-axis, I use the signal-to-noise and distortion ratio as a proxy for resolution. And so these data points correspond to conference publications between 1997 and 2004. And the lower a point is, the better it is. So what you see then is that the leading edge snaps onto a slope that is roughly 2 times increase in energy per 6 dB in resolution. So this was the leading edge trade-off slope in 2004. But if we advance time and go to 2009 and today, 2014, you see that now the leading edge, and specifically above 50 dB resolution, snaps onto a different slope that corresponds to the thermal trade-off that we just discussed, which is 4x per bit. So you see these slopes and practical trade-offs, they change over time. So in summary, again, to repeat this so that it's clear, in the old days, a figure of merit that used the 2x per bit trade-off was perfectly acceptable. Today, in high-resolution designs beyond 50 dB, a 4x trade-off, it's much more suitable. So how does this relate now to the figures of merit that are used today? So the Walden figure of merit encodes exactly this old trade-off, 2x per bit. It takes the power, divides it by the sample rate, times 2 to the effective number of bits, which is a 2x per bit trade-off. However, more recent figures of merit, such as the Schreier figure of merit in dynamic range and the Schreier figure of merit in signal-to-noise and distortion ratio, take a 4x per bit trade-off. And I have listed reference below here that first defined these metrics. So just to show you what are typical numbers and how do these figure of merit actually approximate the leading edge, I'm going back to my energy plot. And here you see the dashed line is the Schreier figure of merit evaluated at 173 dB. And you see that actually is the borderline of the state of the art for high resolution. For the low resolution, it is still more appropriate to use the Walden figure of merit. Again, this is a 2x per 6 dB trade-off slot. And that would be for converters below 50 dB. And the limit line here is at 5 femtojoules per conversion step. So now let us shift gear and actually return to this question of speed dependency. So once you've decided what is the right figure of merit for your design, based on resolution, for example, you can actually plot the figure of merit as a function of speed. And so this is what I did here for the SNDR-based Schreier figure of merit. And so on the x-axis is FOMs, on the y-axis is FOMs, on the x-axis is frequency. And so you see an interesting observation here, and that is at low frequency, it is relatively easier to achieve a good figure of merit, whereas as you push frequency, you go through a corner frequency at which the efficiency deteriorates. Interestingly, the slope of this fit line is about 10 dB per decade drop, and it corresponds to power going quadratic with speed. So it's now interesting, once you have a representation like this, again to go back in time to track trends. So I'm going now back to 2009, and not surprisingly, you see that the low frequency asymptote moves down, the high frequency asymptote moves left, and I can continue this to 2014. And we see over the past 10 years an aggregate improvement of 13 dB, or slightly more than 4x improvement in the low frequency efficiency, and a factor of 60 improvement in the high frequency asymptotes. So this is an enormous progress rate, and so it begs the question, how far can we go? How much longer can this improvement continue? So for that, we obviously need to speculate. There are no clear answers to this, but let's think about the two asymptotes separately. First, the high frequency asymptote, a 60x improvement that we saw in the last decade, is most likely linked in large parts to the FT improvement of the transistors. Transistors have gotten about 10 times faster in the last 10 years, and so that may explain a factor of 10 in that overall factor of 60. The rest, in my opinion, must have come just from better design, interesting new architectures, and so on. So as long as we continue to be creative and technology keeps scaling, then we should be fine advancing this asymptote further. On the low asymptote, low frequency asymptote, it's a little more complicated, because here we're really running into fundamental physics. One way to look at this is to evaluate the minimum possible energy that you can spend on a data conversion. And one proxy for this that is well accepted is the energy it takes to process a single sample with a class B switch capacitor circuit. And the energy number happens to be 8 kT times SNR, where K is the Boltzmann constant and T is temperature. And that actually corresponds to a FOMs of 192 dB. So if you put this on this chart, you see we have quite a bit of headroom and we're getting close to about 180 dB. Perhaps the future will get us to 186 dB, but in my opinion, it'll be very, very difficult to go beyond this simply because circuits are substantially more complex than the circuit considered in the limit, in the 192 dB limit. So in summary, this presentation made a few points that I want you to remember. The first one is figures of merit have to be simple to be useful. And this is why we factor in only the key performance metrics into them. As a consequence, when you report your results, you need to go beyond just reporting the figures of merit. You need to construct a table that highlights all the important aspects in your design. Lastly, when you use a figure of merit, it's very important that you're aware that these are based on certain assumptions that may not always apply and, in fact, change over time. So the right way to use this and the right way to deal with this is to compare only designs with similar conversion rates and resolutions. And from today's perspective, if you work on a high-resolution converter beyond 50 dB SNDR, you should use a Schreier-based figure of merit with a thermal slope. If you work on low resolution designs, you should use the Walden figure of merit, which has a 6 dB per bit slope. Thank you.